I want you to sit down and write your biography, your autobiography. What happened the decade that you were born, and what happened the next decade. But then, and writing is great, because all these things are going to pass when you pass. So then I said, well, that's dumb. Put it on audio tape. So we started audio taping it. And I think it's up to as far as 1956, which were very big years. Very big years. And I said, that's dumb. Put it on videotape. You know, why go 2-3 generations back as far as technology? Put it on videotape. And that's what I'm doing. In fact, I finished it. But I've got to go back and play these on videotape. In other words, I sit down at a desk and play these on a videotape player. Excuse me, an audio tape player. And then get the whole story.
One day I mailed a tape cassette, you know, a little audio cassette, not a video cassette like this, and I mailed it to Providence, Rhode Island. And I came back in the afternoon, and I was lying down, I got a telephone call, and the man said on the other end, he says, are you Glendora Folsom? And I said, yes. And he says, did you send a package to Providence, Rhode Island this morning? And I said, yes. And he says, well, it's humming. To me, it was kind of funny, but to him, it wasn't. And so he says, you get over here just as fast as you can. Well, I get over there, you know, and here's all these postal inspectors, you know, they all have guns on their hips and everything, you know. And they stood right by me and said, you unwrap that. And sure enough, it was humming. What had happened was that the cassette, for some reason, that little player, you know, something hit that button and it started to roll. And can you imagine being in the post office and hearing all this foolish stuff coming out of the package?
I met Glendora when I was working at the public access TV station in Manhattan in 2006. I knew her mostly from the phone conversations we had before I met her face to face. She told me stories of early television and her days as a port-a-pack pioneer. She was amazed by the ever-changing media technology and described in detail her efforts to keep up with it. I was amazed by her devotion to produce media in her later years. Glendora would tell me one joke per phone call and leave more on my voicemail when I could not answer. She sent me handwritten notes in the mail. One had her show details on the back of a photocopied image of a young Glendora with Bob Hope. I was intrigued. Glendora persistently invited me to her home upstate, which she called the Happy House, to eat a vegan lunch and to chat about public access TV. After several months, I took her up on the offer.
There's nobody else like you, and you want to know why? Because God's running a complicated universe, and there are jobs to do, and God needs those jobs to be done, and He made you with a special set of talents to do that one job that nobody else can do. So at 22 or earlier, if you can, sit down and listen and say, what did you create me to do? I did that. I did it sincerely. The answer kept coming up, television. This was in 1952 or 3 when television was everything. People didn't go to the bathroom because they were watching television. They waited until the commercial. And all these aerials sprung up on houses and made the whole landscape look funny.
And if there were any room, and the nervous new father said to the man next to him, here, have a...
No, this is the thing I want you to see. This school has begun, okay?
Okay.
School has begun. It's raining cats and dogs. How do I know?
I just stepped into a poodle. I have announcements, and I will help you with your announcement. Do you have anything you want people to know? I'll help you every way I can with your announcements. It takes me about a month, though, to get them on the tube. I have an announcement. I would like to start by reading to you the First Amendment to the Constitution of the United States of America. The First Amendment. Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof, or abridging the freedom of speech, or of the press, or the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances.
You can't get into NBC or CBS because it's like trying to get into the castle or the fortress of Henry VIII. So I went way up into the backwoods into Pittsfield, Massachusetts, and I started my first show. I wanted to start out small, so it was a kids' show. The show moved from 15 minutes a week to 45 minutes a day in Manchester, New Hampshire, on Channel 9, WMUR, and it was the SS Glendora. And I told the kids that the SS stood for steamship, and they said, no, it stands for stupid show. Milton Bradley became the sponsor of the SS Glendora. The people who were behind Captain Kangaroo got in and tried to talk Milton Bradley out of dropping me and sponsoring Captain Kangaroo. That was not nice, was it? Well, somehow or other, this advertising agency in Hartford prevailed, and they went through with it.
Do you have any of this on tape anymore?
There was no tape.
It was all live and no tape.
No tape and no film. Broadcast TV had never been commensurate with the public's airwaves. The airwaves belonged to the public. And the FCC, through its greed and avarice and acquisitiveness, let the broadcast corporations, you, Mr. Paley, you, General Sarnoff, you took the public's airways and you made billions on it. And that was not right. And so cable TV came along with a multiple channel capacity. Thank God that the Congress of the United States ruled that the cable operators had to relegate a channel to the public. That was the beginning of PEG, Public Educational and Government Access.
The welfare department seems to have a stigma attached, and yeah. And people are just too proud to ask for help.
Not me.
Marie, would you tell us?
A woman's place is all kinds of things. It's a collective mm-hmm. of women, of seven women and seven kids living here together, with the main purpose of keeping a retreat for women going.
How are you today?
I'm very fine. How are you?
Oh, good, thank you. It's a beautiful day.
Yes, indeed. It's delightful.
Would you tell us if you're depressed by New York City's finances?
I'm very depressed. I foresaw this. Anybody could see. Wastefulness.
Wasteful.
Corruption.
Yes.
Are you nostalgic for anything, or what are you nostalgic for?
That's a very good question. You're really good. No, I'm just so happy now. I don't seem to want anything that came from the past. I don't want to seem to go back. You know, Thomas Wolfe wrote the book, You Can't Go Home Again. And you know, I told you about little Jimmy Talbot, 10 years old, and he came back to see me at 62. He was trying to go home again. And from his reports and from the things he told me, I could see that he found out you can go back, but you can't go home again. It's not there. It's not there anymore. And I don't know whether you've been around when somebody dies or not. What do the survivors do? They get a dumpster. And you see that person's life thrown into a dumpster. We are in the town of Ghent. We're going to the museum. It's the Glendora Franklin Public Access Pro Se Newspaper Museum. And there is a Glendora Franklin Living Trust that funds this museum in perpetuity, we hope. These are videotapes. You don't remember this, Victoria, before you were born. But videotapes used to be 2-inch. When videotape started out, that's all we had was 2-inch.
Wow.
And a half-hour reel spool weighed about 60 pounds. That's all we had. And then Sony came out with, or the Japanese, I don't know which, I think it was Sony, came out with a helical scan. And when you had the helical scan, the tape went around in a helix. Therefore, you didn't need this. And they came out with a Sony Portapak, which was a camera that weighed 8 pounds and a recorder that weighed 16 pounds. That made public access possible. Now, the museum has an index. And for every box, it gives the column. This happens to be column 1. And it gives the number of the rows. And then it tells you what's in the box. What would this be? This would be legal papers, folks. This is Cablevision. When I first started to sue Cablevision, I started suing Cablevision at a very early age.
When?
1993. And this is the story of Suzanne McCormick, whose husband died 18 years ago and left her $24 million, and she hasn't seen one penny of it. You want to know where it went? It went to Bankers Trust. It went to White and Case Law Firm. It went to the lawyers. This is how crooked the surrogate court is. And someday, it's a whole day to tell you how crooked the guardianship court is. And this Glendora versus Savarino for taking Glendora off of the air, to the TV rather. So goodbye, you crooked judges. We're going to church today and we will pray for you that you will find your peace and happiness in your inner person. This is for you judges. Breathe on them breath of God, fill them with life anew, that they may love as thou dost love and do what thou wouldst do. Breathe on them breath of God till they are wholly thine, until their glows with thy spirit divine.
This is episode number 4000 of A Chat with Glendora. The show will feature some great old clips from the past, as well as some new behind-the-scenes footage. Plus, we'll find out some things about Glendora that you might not already know. Stay tuned.
Hi there, everybody. This is Glendora, Chat with Glendora. And Andrew Hersman is helping me celebrate my 4,000th TV show on public access. In 1987, I got a call from the David Letterman show. And they'd heard about A Chat with Glendora on cable TV, and they invited me to be a guest on it.
Folks, please welcome the happiness lady, Glendora. Hi, Glendora. How
Pleasure to see you. Please have a seat. Now tell me about your personal recipe for happiness. You're known as the happiness lady.
Well,
is that what they say?
No.
What do they call you?
Glendora.
Yeah.
And what did you say your name was?
I'm Dave. My last night.
You are a very good interviewer.
Well, thank you.
And I'm going to recommend you for a raise.
Thank you.
The recipe for happiness, David, is that there's one thing in this world that you can do better than anybody else. And if you will go by yourself, you will find out what that is. And you will do it, and you'll be happy. Now, if you don't do it, David, it's going to nag at you every second of your life.
So you find out what it is that you're good at.
No, the one thing that you can do better than anybody else.
The one thing you can do better than anyone else, and you just concentrate on that.
Yes, you do.
And then that'll make you happy.
Well, sure, because you'll get everything you want.
Yeah.
The Cable Act of 1984 came out, Title 47, the United States Code, Section 521, et sequitur, the health and the welfare of the public. Congress called us an electronic soapbox. Congress was calling us a public forum. Public forums have a lot of power. Mm-hmm. Folks, they could just change two or three words in the public access law, and it would be gone. So I thank you, Congress. I thank you, cable operators, that we have public access. It's a great, great, great phenomenon. It's true free speech. We are an electronic soapbox.
Hi, Glendora. Tom Goggy here from Denver.
Well, of course, after that, I went to the law libraries, and I started looking up the law, and it was overwhelming, but I certainly knew what my case was, that it was, at that time, I wasn't knowledgeable enough to articulate it as editorial control. And back in those days, the FCC was a whole lot different than it is now, and a whole lot more competent. And I had the insight from above to call the FCC, and fortunately a young man answered, and I told him what they had done. And he says, look up the United States Code, Title 47, Section 521 et sec. He says, look up 531E. I went back to the library and I looked it up, and there articulated was everything I needed. No cable operator shall exercise editorial control over public access. And that's exactly what they had done, and I had the record. They took the program off of the TV, out of editorial control.
So So the oral argument for that, folks, is going to be before the United States Court of Appeals, Second Circuit, Foley Square, 17th floor. Come, you are invited. And you don't have to be invited. Courts are a public process. Remember that. You walk into any court that you want, and you watch, and you listen, and you observe, and you find out what's being done wrong.
The Westchester Court ruled, and the only thing Cablevision's lawyer, Park Avenue lawyer, could say to Judge Silverman was, could we have 30 days? So they waited 30 days, they put the program back on the TV. This was a tremendous blow to Cablevision, because Cablevision was used to saying, I don't care what the law is, I'm going to do it anyhow. And it still is their attitude. But this time, they lost.
When would this be? It'd be somewhere around 1955-56. WRGB Schenectady, General Electric. I don't even think that looks like Glendora. Charles Elson was handsome. Hi, little TV guest. Now this is actual. This is Canaan, Connecticut. There's some little Glendora fans. And there's some little Glendora mateys that came down with her. I wonder if Jim Talbert's one of them. Isn't that endearing? Oh, what fun.
I just have a question for you. The name Glendora is quite unique. Were you ever on Channel 6, WRTV?
That's where it started.
Okay, well, you're talking to one of your avid viewers. I remember the show. I remember your outfit. I can see you just as if it were yesterday.
Oh, good.
The Freddy Fryhofer show, and I have a squiggle from that.
Oh, that's marvelous.
As I sift through the collection of Glendora's artifacts, I realize that her six-decade career as a media producer mirrors the changes not only in television technology, but in the structure of television ownership and distribution. In the 1950s and 60s, Glendora was a local broadcast TV star, but as the TV business became consolidated by large companies, access to channels and opportunities disappeared for local independent TV personalities. As more and more television content became nationally syndicated, by the 1970s, public access cable TV was the only avenue left for local voice.
April 16th, 10:33 p.m.
Yeah, hello. I saw your show on public access, and I must say it touched me deeply. I don't know what to say. You're just a wonderful human being. That's it. Thank you.
Hello, Glendora. We are watching a show on the Community Access TV network in Connecticut. An enjoyable program. Keep it up.
End of message.
I have spent half of my life going from one format to another. These are returns from my TV stations. Those will all be gone. You come back in 4 days, every one of those will be used up and gone out to a TV station again. This is one mailing of a chat with Glendora, probably for some month. Well, it would tell you right down here. $100, 20 cents to mail out a chat with Glendora. Now, that's probably another question you have. Why not only do you spend your time and your ergs of energy, but why do you spend so much money? And this is only mailing. Then you have to buy videotapes. Now it's DVDs. And then you have to buy camcorders that you wear out. It's played from the mini DV. It goes into this one right here. This is the bottom DVD. And then it comes out of the bottom DVD and goes into the character generator. Out of the character generator, up to this DVD, up to this DVD, up to this DVD, up to this DVD, and up to this DVD, and I can't get these two to give a picture. And I was wondering if you could help me, but you don't have time, I don't think, now. Anyway, it goes from this DVD over to the bottom, VHS, the Sanyo, up to the next VHS, so forth, so forth, and so forth, so that I can make, when the whole thing is operating, I can make 15 dubs at the same time. Well, I have to, if it's going to 60 TV stations.
The woman was being interviewed for a job, and the man says, what is your date of birth? And she said, November 15th. And he says, what year? She said, every year.
Hey, Mary.
Hi, Glendora.
How are you, honey?
I'm good. How are you?
Good, thank you.
Bye.
I have 20 beautiful shows for you for next month.
They're open.
Hello?
Hi, hon.
Hello.
Hello?
Hello?
Hi there.
How are you? Are you recording?
Boo!
You can't have that on here.
Okay.
Please.
Huh?
It's a government rule.
Yeah, but I want to know why. What's your reason?
To have film or any production of photos or imagery in this building.
Yeah, but don't tell me why. I'll have to call them up in Washington, D.C. and to ask them
why.
And I'll make a video on it. I'll make a program of it.
Okay, sorry.
I don't see how it makes the post office insecure. What? Do you know what number regulation it is?
No, I don't.
You don't?
No.
How have you been?
Good. How are you?
Good, thanks. This is Franklin's teddy bear. Franklin got him when he was just a little. When he was only a year old, and that would be in 1919. Little pants, aren't they cute? And this chair is where he went into a coma on the morning of October 18th. You see that calendar up there? That's why I keep that calendar, because it was over his bed that year. The year of his death day. This is his mother and father. This is Franklin and Glendora in 1958. Excuse me. Yeah, 1950. Yeah, that's right. 1958. They'd been married only 4 or 5 years then.
May thy rich grace impart strength to our faith. Heart, our zeal inspire. Oh, hear us while we pray. Take all our guilt away. Oh, let us from this day be wholly thine. And no Victoria. This is August the 15th. Half of the month is over. We are too busy. We do not value one another. We're all too busy. We're all too busy. I think I will have a funeral. And I think I will invite you and others.
Next message.
I dreamed that I went to heaven and that I didn't like it. I asked to come back to Earth. I love Earth. I love this life. I really don't want to leave it. Mary Kilser, my neighbor to the north, will probably be the first to know. And I want it very clear that I'm not to go to the hospital, and I want it very clear that I'm not to have resuscitation. And then you should come as quickly as you can.
Take all of the DVD recorders, and then you would take all of the desk boards and put them into your van, and then you'd take the 6 filing cabinet, and then you'd take the 4 folding chairs, and you would take them, come around and take the bed, and then take the rugs, the 2 desk boards, the 6 filing cabinets, the 4 chairs, the 22 VHS DVDs, and then you would put the bed way in the back at the stern of the
museum, and then you would lay down the rugs. This is the funeral when I go to heaven. Bye.
And the people bowed and prayed to the neon gods they made. And the sign flashed out its warning in the words that it was forming. And the sign said the words of the prophets are written on the subway walls, in tenement halls, amongst the sound of silence.
I just handed them. Right there, Mr. Chef, over there by the pot.
Oh, yes, right here. And we're all going to have some delicious food and beverages, and we're going to have a great time.
And everybody's invited to speak, right?
Everybody is invited to speak.
Except you.
And
no, I can't speak. No.
we'd like to limit it, if we could, to
40.
10 to 12 minutes per speaker.
Are you going to die right there on the spot?
You don't want to be the late Glendora.
No. Hi, Glendora. It's Barbara Goldberg, and I was very happy to hear from you. But I was kind of upset by what you invited me to, was your funeral.
My funeral, March 6th.
I'm hoping that's another joke, or I'm not sure what to think. But I hope you're well. And please give me a call back and allay my worries.
And the cat's in the cradle and the silver spoon, little boy blue and the man in the moon. When you're coming home, Dad, I don't know when, but we'll get together then. You know we'll have a good time then.
When Franklin went to heaven on the night of October the 18th, 2003, at exactly 8:10 p.m., his soul made the flight. He had asked me before, of course, to call all of his people. And so I started calling his people. And for some reason, I started enumerating them. One, two, three. And I have done that ever since. The count of the telephone numbers that I have dialed since October 18th, 2003 is 19,000. Here are the Monday calls. Here's the Saturday calls that I would have been doing today. Friday, Thursday, Wednesday, Tuesday, Monday. And here are the TV stations. And here are calls that are way, can you read that, folks? Way ahead. I won't be doing those for a week or two.
Oh, good. Even better for the parents.
Well, we're going to the Women's Club of the St. Luke's Lutheran Church. Very sweet people who try to do all kinds of kind things all over the world. So we're going to the women's dinner, and I invited, I think, about 10 or 12 women. And the only two who came were Victoria Carrezzi and Sarah Schubert.
We'd like to welcome you to the third annual, or sort of annual, women's dinner.
This is kolka. This is vegetarian turkey. And if they have meat, I'll have to have a substitute.
Which I'm sure there will be meat of some kind. Oops. All right, how's that?
What? Oh, more.
More?
Yeah.
Can you see the name? Your mic is
American. The men look nice. They're all dressed up.
Yes.
I love it. I love having the men wait on us. Hello!
Shall I toss?
When are you on Berkshire?
When are you on? Every night.
Every night.
At what time and what channel? Channel 7. No, channel 8. For 2 hours, 7 to 9 p.m., Monday through Friday.
Do you wear your hat?
Oh, yeah.
She always has a hat on.
Yeah,
it's the hats that throw me off, I have to be honest.
The hats throw me off. What's that mean, throw you off?
Turn you off? I'm not sure why you wear the hat all the time.
What's that?
I'm not sure why you wear a hat all the time.
Why don't you wear yourself?
My brains are cold, and I have to keep them warm.
That's
a good answer.
It
makes people look at my hat instead of my face. How's that? No.
Garçon.
I don't think so.
Could I see the head garçon, please, the head waiter?
Keeps the Emmanuel Lutheran Church going.
Oh, does she?
Yes, she does.
I still haven't found your station on TV.
Well, I'm pretty sure. Do you have Time Warner? Or do you?
Yes, I have Time Warner.
8:30 p.m. Monday night, channel 23. Yeah, public access. 8:30 p.m.
8:30?
Yeah.
Oh, I tried at 8 o'clock.
Tell them about the Apple Festival.
Huh?
Tell them about the Apple Festival on September 27th.
Well, it's going to be held at the Emmanuel Lutheran Church in Stuyvesant Falls on Route 9. And the hours are from 9 to 3 on a Saturday morning. Is this going to be on TV?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
You made my day.
Everybody's TV will be broke.
So there's 25. And now I've already made a mistake. There's another 25.
It'll be 26 and so on.
Well, you'll have to make it 25A, I think. Something like that.
Sure.
26, 27, 28. And see, all that's in here is just one DV disc.
The one program I have to copy.
Yeah, this is the one show. And it's show number 547228.
Every single one of those goes out every month. I think anything that you would be doing with public access is done more so with the internet. And anyone can do their own, everyone can have their own public access. They can have their own website, they can have their own YouTube account, they can do their own thing. And it's a lot easier to do online, I think. Or maybe just easier to access, even.
The problem there is that there's billions of sites on the YouTube. And you get lost, maybe, whereas in public access you didn't. You know, there's just so many things to see, right, on the YouTube, that you just might get lost and nobody will ever find you. Let me ask you this. Isn't it sad that there wasn't any legislation made that satellites had to do public access?
Mm-hmm.
Only cable TV's stations have had to do it.
Why was cable made to do it originally?
Back in the late 1960s, people like George Stoney agitated to the municipalities that here are these cable companies stringing their lines around along our public highways, their hours. Therefore, those cable companies should pay the municipalities a percentage of their revenue.
Right.
And they agitated so successfully that they finally made this a reality and Congress put out legislation.
Right.
And then if we find out that the response is down, the telephone calls are down, and when I go out in the public, few and fewer people say, I watched you on TV last night or I've seen you on TV. If that goes down, then we possibly could stop the television distribution and we could just rely on the internet. But I will not stop videotaping. I cannot let God's kaleidoscope go by without making a record of it. The moon that comes up, the rainstorms, sunrises and sunsets, what the cats do that's so funny, what the raccoon does. I can't stop videotaping that. This is the century that I'm in. These are the things that are happening in this century. A record has to be made, and I have to do my part. God's sunshine. God's creation, God's variety, God's beauty, God's colors, God's design, God's manufacturing,
God's precision, God's perfection, God's love, the fun and laughter and joy of God. Now you see, you do that, I started it right there. If I keep that up, when I get to 10 after with this second hand, I've had a moment of ecstasy with God. And the more of those you have, the more successful, the more appreciated, the more fulfilled, and the more correct you will be. Now you see, that's why I have a second. I have one here because this is my writing desk. I have one clock there because that's my editing desk. I have one over here in the kitchen when I wash the dishes. I can have one of those moments of supreme happiness anytime I choose.
God has never been in a hurry. Jesus lived 30 long years on the earth before beginning his active public ministry. Was Jesus right on schedule? Was he fulfilling God's precise timetable? Yes. Few things worth attaining can be accomplished in a day. What matters is the slow, steadfast, obedient pursuit of the goals to which God calls you.
Glendora has a lot of advice for people aimed at the attainment of happiness and fulfillment of one's hopes and dreams. Her self-published how-to books include The Happy Book, Be Perfect, and This is the Answer to Everything. All books are self-distributed on Glendora's cable TV show. Glendora's love in physics was started in graduate school in the late 1960s. She wrote and published three subsequent volumes throughout the 1970s.
Physics is about force, and force is God, and force is love. If there's a force of love, there's also an equal and opposite force, which is evil. Sometimes I wondered if that isn't why there is evil, because you wouldn't have any upward progress unless you had evil. So force, and then the equal force, which is evil, pushes it up, and so then more love has to come along to get rid of that evil, and that pushes it up again. Somehow, do you think that could be progress? So that's how I went into graduate school, into physics, in the university, to try to understand the universe. And that was the year that the two men walked on the moon. That's nothing to sneeze at, Dottie Com.
And when you were at school and you were studying with other people, were they studying similar things about God and physics?
Oh, no. Well, they all poo-pooed my idea that about the convergence of electromagnetic waves.
What were their reasons?
Well, they're of a different intellect. They're of a different orientation. They don't want metaphysics. They want physics. They don't want philosophy. They want to bang electrons and see what kind of a path they make. And of course, their doing that led to the atomic bomb and the hydrogen bomb.
You know what you're going
women like best about shopping at Tops? The people, everybody is so helpful. You know, there's a manager and the checkout girls and then the stock boys. And those stock boys are pretty good looking, too. And you know what else you're going to like about Tops Friendly Markets? The produce. The produce is super fresh. Super fresh, folks. Just like that guy who took your daughter out last night. Remember, Tops is a supermarket with people where you don't have to talk to yourself. That's why.
We've got extra special specials.
We're buying for 40 people.
And how do you know who's coming?
No, but you had to pick a number. So I picked 40.
Did you invite a lot of people?
Oh, I told everybody that I talked to.
How do most people react when you tell them you're having your own funeral?
Well, the first thing they are, that they're speechless. And then they want me to explain it, and then I do.
And then what do you say?
They don't really say much that I can remember. Now, Marie, what's come in new for cameras?
Nothing at the moment. Cameras are supposed to be getting done on Monday.
Okay. Did you hear about the man who said, if I ever have a heart transplant, I want the heart of my boss? It's never been used.
No.
I can make 13 half-hour television shows in an hour. I did that yesterday. Put all the titles on them and make 3 dubs of each one. And that's 8, 9, or 10 hours. And I can feel fine. I go on one shopping trip, and I am exhausted. Task 16. Produce. I get an A for the task, but I get a C for pure thoughts. Task 17. Frozen. An A for the task, but a C for pure thoughts. 3 jars of peanut butter, 3 heads of lettuce, 15 oranges, 15 apples, 3 bags of grapes. Now we just do the paper cups and paper plates. And we're done, Vicki.
Unless you can think of something we might have forgotten.
Nope, I think that's it.
Kathy, I'm going to have my funeral on Saturday. It's at 2 p.m. in Kinderhook.
Okay.
I always wanted to go to my own funeral.
To hear all the nice things people say about you.
Yes. I love you, I love you, I love you. I talk to the insides of the camera. Now you are being videotaped. There you are. Computer's waiting for any in calls. I haven't heard when the hearse is coming. I don't know when the hearse is coming, but I'll be ready at 10 o'clock. So next thing is to exercise the body and get dressed up in black.
Friends of Glendora, community members, church members, and Glendora herself, this is a celebration of life. And we're celebrating not only the life of Glendora, but the life of all of us. And Glendora simply serves as our catalyst for doing so today. 2 years ago now, Krista and I attended a concert choir reunion. And Glendora was very interested in that and wanted to attend with us. And so we traveled down together. Now, as the night had progressed, Glendora had fallen behind on counting her blessings. All right? So she had quite a few to make up. So what we did was that as we drove home, we each took turns counting blessings for Glendora so that she could catch up with her 15 blessings every hour. So we did that, And after we dropped off Glendora, my wife said to me, "It was like we were traveling with an angel."
Thank you, Pastor.
You're not going to be controlled by outside conditions any longer. Instead, you're going to control outside conditions. You are going to be in charge. You're no longer to be a victim of circumstances. Inside of you, you're going to be stronger than anything outside of you.
Go ahead, I'll hold it.
How about that, cutting your own cake and your own funeral?
Yeah! That's great.
Mr. George Dixon, stand up and tell us about your blog radio show.
Oh, no, I'd rather talk about Glendora.
I'm leaving.
Come here, Dave, come here. For years, I knew Glendora over watching Public Access TV. And the reason she caught my attention, besides being a little eccentric with her hats and so forth, which she had character, there's no doubt, but she was also very knowledgeable. And I learned from her things that I couldn't have learned in the academic world of today. She may sound crazy at times in some of her thinking, but she has been right on the money. She's been very sharp. It was good to see Glendora has kept her faith and kept her posture in all her work. And she has done nothing but give of herself and partake. And, you know, I admire her for that.
Oh, Danny boy, the pipes are calling. From glen to glen and down the mountainside. The summer's gone. And all the rows are calling. It's you, must go and I must buy. But come ye back when summer's in the meadow, or when the valley's hushed and white with snow. It's here I'll be, in sunshine or in shadow. Oh, Danny boy, oh, Danny boy, I love you so.
Fellowship. Fellowship of one human being to another. Think of all the different kinds of friendships there were. Why, I don't think you could see anything more beautiful. See the sunset, Victoria. I saw the sunrise this morning, and now I see the sunset.
New DIE instructions. They were started on October 21st, 2009, Anno Domini, and the time used was 17 hours. Glendora is of sound mind and sound sense, and that's why she didn't use a lawyer. Please notify the Kinderhook Reformed Church that Glennie's gone to heaven and they helped her. And Andrew Herzman said that he would keep a chat with Glendora going after Glennie goes to heaven. I've told you about this. Enforce adamantly, no resuscitation, no hospitals, and no tubes. When everything is out of the Glendora Happy House, the Glendora Franklin Museum should look like this. Here it is, folks. It should look like this. This is the port. This is the starboard. These are columns 1 to 27 on the port and 1 to 27 on the starboard. This is the bed. These are the two desks, three desks, juxtaposed. Glendora has six camcorders, 18 VCR DVD combos, four VHS recorders, a tripod, the external microphones, two of them. 18 VCR DVD combos, four VHS recorders, a tripod, and 8 millimeter videotapes, a dozen or so mini DV
videotapes. And right now she has 200 blank DVDs. Preserve them, don't sell them. Dear Glendora and God, you have made me a successor trustee of the Glendora Franklin Living Trust. I promise you both that I will not use nor let anybody else use the money in the trust fund other than for the preservation of the Glendora Franklin Museum for the preservation of the Pro Se public access newspaper record.
Here's a J.
Repeat, Glendora does not want any tubes in her after she is brain dead. She has got along fine all these years, brain dead.
Here's the last piece.
It's the history of public access, and it's the history of somebody who was devoted to it. It's always been a record of God's kaleidoscope, the moon last night, the leaves falling.
Teach me thy patience, one with thee, endure a close circumpany, in faith that keeps work sweet and strong, in trust that triumphs over wrong.
I'm in love with a dolly named Glendora. She works in the window of a big department store. Eyes of blue, hair like gold. Never been young, but she'll never get old. Oh, Glendora, I want to see more of you. Oh, Glendora. To see more of you.
Should we turn off our cameras now? One, two, three, four.